The insurance industry undergoing major digital transformation. It's not just about cost and premiums and actuary tables anymore, but the underlying data, AI-based transactional agents, consumerization, the market, individual, environment, socioeconomic, convenience, different generational preference, and more. How can we trust the use of big data when personal data is still handled in a non-transparent manner? How can we turn insurance into an engaging product? WeFox believes that by having the people owning and controlling their data and the ethical usage of it, consumers will feel safer to embrace technology. Thanks for joining our session. Insurers aim to reduce risk with big data, but is that risk for you? Julian, good afternoon.
Well, it's a pleasure to be here. Thank you.
Yeah. Clearly, there are three topics I believe audience may be interested in talking with you. One is around entrepreneurship, right? You and I both done entrepreneurship. I think sharing a little bit about the entrepreneurship and about your company that you built, the WeFox that I'm very proud to be associated with. And then the lastly, also talk about the work you're doing to address the public need around tracking applications that you have worked with the non-profit, I guess it's called Healthy Together.
Yes.
And I understand it's a Gesund Zusammen.
Gesund Zusammen.
Gesund Zusammen. So I would be very interested in understanding more about that. I think there's a study subject that we can talk. What would it be in your WeFox journey? What would it be success look like? Let's say 3 to 5 years out. What are you envisioning?
So what WeFox does is digitize insurance. Mm-hmm. And insurance is today something that most people don't like.
It is just pay and pay and pay.
Yeah, it's painful, right? essentially, what you do is you enter a couple of data points, mm-hmm. variables, right? Mm-hmm. Your age, your gender, and so forth.
Your address.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, like 15 data points. Mm-hmm. You get a price.
Yeah.
You start paying for it. You start forgetting what's actually in the policy.
Right.
Something bad happens. Mm-hmm. You need to take the policy, fine print. You read through the fine print. Paper. Mm-hmm. And then in the best case, they pay the money back. So terrible customer experience, right? Mm-hmm. And we are in front of the third data revolution. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So what changes in the next few years is that everyone will own 15 devices mm-hmm. in his life. Mm-hmm. And the amount of real-time data that's collected about people is so much more valuable to understand people's risk. Mm-hmm. So the third data revolution, the IoT data revolution, will have a big impact on any industry, mm-hmm. on every industry, mm-hmm. but on insurance especially big, mm-hmm. Because insurance is based on data.
Right.
And what we believe is that what we can contribute to is turning insurance into a really engaging product, mm-hmm. into a product that people love. And that provides real safety. Mm-hmm. And what we see is that based on contextual data, so mm-hmm. knowing much more about customers in real time, mm-hmm. we can understand what is their risk right now, mm-hmm. and we can also help them reduce the risk that they're exposed right now to prevent mm-hmm. something bad from happening, right?
So, Julian, if I can translate a little bit, the old industry was really based on traditional demographic driven, and which is basically your age, your address, probably dictate your risk profile much more than what you really are.
Exactly.
Whereas today, with number of IoT device, you know so much more about the way we live, our habits, and our behaviors, and what we even consume, and how we even drive. All those information will give much better insight around personal risk profile. So demographic to personal, and that journey is through digitalization.
Absolutely.
And that is what's going to disrupt this industry.
Absolutely. Right. And it will become such a beautiful product, mm-hmm. and because it will become a friend in your life that gives you advice on how to live a longer, mm-hmm. and happier life mm-hmm. without the terrible tragedies. Mm-hmm. And because today insurance is only there to pay after something terrible has happened.
Right.
But if we can prevent the terrible things from happening, we can make people live longer mm-hmm. and increase the quality of their life.
So basically, knowing a lot about us, this information is not only about risk, understanding the risk, but it really is about behavior change.
Absolutely.
It's about the change that's going to make us live better. And because we all know more about where we are, what our risk is, we can change the risk by being more proactive, by doing more exercise, or by eating the right food, or not going to the bar as much, all that type of stuff. Is that what you're saying?
Absolutely. And of course, the freedom of the individual
right.
and the ethical usage of data, these two things are central. But if we nail these two things, mm-hmm. Then this is the future. And we're talking about one of the most engaging products mm-hmm. of the future of humanity.
So let's talk about this kind of the other side of any data, which is about really about two areas, in my view. One is around security of your data. And the second aspect is really privacy of your data. And these two are fundamental to, in a way, human rights. And if you violate that, then that'll become a compromise that people doesn't want to take. So how do you manage your data, your client's data, and also providing the right advice that are relevant but not yet violating that principle?
So I think we have to differentiate between a pre-consciousness time and a post-consciousness time about data.
Mm-hmm.
And we still live in the pre-consciousness time about data. So we live in what I call second data revolution, the internet. And in the last 20 years, what has happened is I told Facebook what I like, I told Google what I'm looking for. The data went through my mind and I communicated it actively. And that has led to a certain consciousness about usage of data. Mm-hmm. I give you data, I receive value, I like it,
mm-hmm.
right? Now with IoT devices, the world changes and we'll create a post consciousness. This is really because these devices in my life, they will talk directly to Facebook, directly to Google, and the data will not go through my own consciousness. So Facebook and Google, they know more about me than I know about myself consciously. Mm-hmm. And that creates a whole different world, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. So I think what we have to do is we have to be good citizens in the pre-consciousness
mm-hmm.
world
mm-hmm.
and need to prepare for the post-consciousness mm-hmm. world. So what is our company doing in the pre-consciousness world? It's really acting with the categorical imperative of Kant.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the only thing I tell the data scientists and the developers and the product managers at WeFox is you don't do anything
Mm-hmm.
right? And we're allowed to do everything mm-hmm. from a regulatory perspective, by the way, right? We are allowed to almost do everything. There's no regulation yet about data. If we look at what we can do now, it's really, of course, adhere to regulations. That's easy
mm-hmm.
Because it's very low bar,
mm-hmm.
Even with GDPR. What we do on top of that is we say we don't do anything with the data that I would not want to be done with my own data.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And that's the guiding principle.
Mm-hmm.
But post this consciousness of data that will come over the next 5 years is actually accelerated through COVID.
Mm-hmm.
We need a new infrastructure, a new global infrastructure
mm-hmm.
That goes into what you said, data privacy and data security. And the answer can only be that the new paradigm must be that data is owned by the individual.
Yes.
And data is stored on decentralized storage.
Where your device is at. Basically, data should belong to the owner of that device rather than data being going up and then owned by someone else. I think that principle is really critical. It's something that Samsung believes in.
Yeah.
We always try to say, your data belongs to you. Let's change subject a little bit to your journey. So tell me about
The journey that you're making is startup to scale up. What are some of the lessons that you have learned and what you're willing to share with other CEOs who wants to be a scale up?
So you start on day one in the living room at the table with your co-founder, and you build a friendship and you build trust. You create an idea, and then that same person, a few years later, leads a company with, you know, 600 people, with, you know, a C-level, with, you know, compliance departments, legal. Like, I mean, these are two different human beings, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. So me, like, 4 years ago mm-hmm. and me today, it's like two different Julians, mm-hmm. right? And I think this really brings out the point that the only
you
way...
You feel like you got two personalities?
Two here. Completely different personalities, mm-hmm. yeah?
Yeah, yeah.
And I think the only way on how this is possible is by every single day reflecting upon your own behavior, your own strengths and weaknesses, and developing on a personal level, constantly, changing every day, thinking about in the evening, what were the things that I could have, I realized are certain patterns from the past that might create energy blockages in the company, and that might have, you know, destroyed value rather than created value in this new setup that I've experienced today. And how can I do this tomorrow in a better way? What of my fundamental beliefs about life should I question based on my experience again?
It's about constant learning and being able to, willing to change in that learning process. It's that mindset.
Absolutely. Yeah. So my advice is to go through this slow and mostly, actually always painful process of challenging your own beliefs.
I want to change the subject to this project on Healthy Together. And clearly you're involved with nonprofit consortium of players. Bring the best mind together and best engineers to do something about this pandemic, right? So tell us about the journey and how you're involved and how do you see it going?
We thought about creating an initiative where we would say we built technology for people that are hit by the crisis, because we have this competency of building technology and it's now more important than ever to use it. What we have been doing is two things. On the one side, we have been building a privacy-first COVID tracing app that makes sure that what I said before, what I think is the biggest paradigm shift of the future of the next 10, 15 years, that the ownership of data goes back to the individual. So that's the principle of the COVID tracing app that we have built. Mm-hmm. So different than, you know, in China, for example, a COVID tracing app that represents the European freedom and personality and privacy rights. Mm-hmm. So that's one thing that we've done because we believe that this is the best tool to help reduce the spread of the virus with technology. And then on the other side, we started an accelerator where we called for innovators to hand in ideas on how to build technology to help people hit by the crisis.
I'm glad you're involved in assembling and being able to coalesce and being able to also innovate in a time like this, which is an opportunity as well as a crisis.
Absolutely. And what we've seen is that there's a new generation of founders who does things for a purpose and not only for money. And this was great over the last 10 weeks to see how all of these entrepreneurs came together and just worked for a common purpose and got all of the motivation from a purpose. Never asking about a contract, never asking about money, who reimburses my resources, never asking about these things, but just saying, we are in a crisis, we have competencies that can help, let's do it, that's it.
It's a solving problems together,
yeah,
rather than about what's my motivation. You know, I think that that also brings up the nonprofit that I've been working with, Extreme Tech Challenge, which you're part of. And the idea behind Extreme Tech Challenge is about helping really startups to focus on UN 17 sustainability goals, whether it is education, whether it's health, whether it's poverty, or inclusiveness. Mm. All those things need to be looked at by, and I think technology can help, and we want to mobilize startup ideas like your accelerator idea to help and solve these problems. And one difference also is working with corporations. Mm. Corporations that can work with, because if Microsoft, Samsung, or Google, or Intel work together, we can accelerate that ideas to the market. And I think that is the idea behind this particular nonprofit that I'm working with. Mm. And I think these two has a really good synergy.
It's a new world. It's a new world. It's really people not just asking what's in it for me, but what's in it for us.
Thank you, Julian. Really appreciate your time. It's a great conversation.
Thank you so much, Yang.
I wish you the best with WeFox journey as well as some of the impact work that you're doing.
Thank you so much, Yang, for the invitation.
Appreciate that.